the creation of social norms also works very well. So, I mean, we managed to do it for other products, let's say, to create social norms, and that people relate to that. If you are talking about tobacco, for example, yeah, the norms have changed, and yeah, smoking is not seen anymore as something cool. If you think about recycling and using, yeah, reusing material and this kind of circular steps, let's say, I think there is the same. If your neighbor stores something, then yeah, people just in general do the same. That's how it works. It's also important not to take this approach of punishment, which doesn't work. So really motivating people to have the right behaviors for the right reasons, but not because they are afraid of something. A rebound effect is a negative action that is made after a positive one has been taken. The most popular example to illustrate what a rebound effect is like to really optimize the electricity in your household by having solar panels and maybe LED lights, and then to therefore think, okay, I can leave all the lights on, it doesn't matter anymore. In terms of packaging, this happens also in some circumstances. We mentioned the use, for example, of more concentrated products to reduce the size of the packaging. That happens quite a lot with laundry detergent, for example. Only they found out that people were actually using twice as much product to do their laundry. So the purpose was kind of, killed at the end. But so that's also something to think through beforehand and to already, there is most of the time a solution. So designers really have to think about the solution. In that case, that's really easy. You just have to have a cap that gives the right dose to the consumers, and the problem is solved. So for consumers, like, sustainable decisions, they are extremely complicated. Each alternative has positive and also negative externalities. And it's very difficult for consumers to compare this alternative. So to really implement the circular economy, it would be really important to make their choices easier, to enable them to compare options. Recently, with a group of students, we really tested what would be the influence of having the traffic lights on the packages that would report on the environmental impact of the package. And you really see that it has strong influences on purchase decisions. So you really see that it could work. So this system should be at the disposal of consumers in a way to enable them to easily make the right decisions, or the decisions they would like to make. Next to that, and it also relates to the fact that, yeah, human beings are a bit lazy. For a circular economy, you need to collect the materials to let them re-enter the loop in a way. So making the facilities to, like the recycling facilities, for example, as easy and easy to use and convenient as possible would really help the circular economy. And yeah, basically it all comes back to price. Like, is it going to be more expensive? And in the end, for many, many consumers, that's the most important variable. So if you have a very nice circular product, but it's sold like three times as much as the other alternative in the category, you're going to touch a very small segment of consumers, which is not ideal to implement the circular economy. So the prices really have to be legitimate, and companies have to think of business models that enable them to bring to the to the market products at an acceptable price for most consumers. Of course, consumers are different, and there are different groups of consumers. So it also depends, on the environmental concern of the person. And I think many people are willing to pay more if they get some emotional value back from the product they buy. So if they have the feeling that they are really making a good action, for example, they are willing to pay more. But that doesn't work for everyone. And for a circular economy to really work, you have to touch as many people as possible, right? So you have to find the price that's acceptable for most people.